डियर फ्रेंड्स, फाइंडिंग इंग्लिश इजी? यस, इट हैज टू बी. इंग्लिश इज वेरी वेरी इजी टू लर्न, प्रोवाइडेड यू आर इंटरेस्टेड इन इट. सो वन आफ्टर द अदर वी हैव फिनिश्ड टू मेनी पोएम्स एंड नाउ कम टू द 12th लेसन, द वाटर. दिस इज सपोज टू बी वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग एंड यू नो वेरी मच रिलेवेंट टू द करंट situation in the society. This water is a story by a foreign author, Chinua Achebe. Chinua Achebe was a Nigerian poet, mainly concentrating on things like, example, like judiciary and the system that is prevailing. But his more focus was on colonization, post-colonization effects. What was the effect of the colonization in Nigeria? He concentrated upon in his stories and novels. Many of you might have learnt about the stories and poem novels, especially written by Chinua Achebe. One best novel is Things Fall Apart, and also the one that we are reading today, The Water. Okay, so this one, this poem, this lesson especially, it talks about how the election system works. It could be because of the sensible and the honest working of certain people, and most of the times it is money that plays a very important role, both in the life of the contestant and also the life of the voter. So how money plays important role, money becomes dominant than ethics, morality, and also your honesty and fidelity towards your leader. So all this is overtaken by money. That is what is seen in this story, The Voter. So I have written only the first part of it, wherein we have three important categories of people, two important characters, and the third one is a group of characters. Okay, the first one we are introduced to is Rufus Okeke. Or in short, brief, you know, he's lovingly called as Roof. Roof is a learned and a hard-working guy. He works very well. He is educated. And he is very humble. Very humble, very down-to-earth. He is not a mischief-monger of the village. So people love him very much. He is the apple of the eye, you know. He is, he just loves, you know, coming back to his village and working over there. People also have lot of respect to Roof because he has not left his village for good, unlike other villagers, unlike other youths of that village. Since though he has studied, though he is educated, he stays back in his village and he wants to, the author mentions that he wants to help the villagers during certain difficult times. Difficult times are when they'll have to take a kind of decision. It's not that the villagers are fools. They are literates. They are wise people. But they need a kind of help by people like Roof, who can guide them what to towards good or bad. They have to decide which one is the best thing for them. So Roof, people like Roof, they help him. And they help the villagers. And therefore, he is loved very much. Two or three important things about Roof is given to us. One thing was he works as a bicycle repairer's apprentice. Bicycle repairer apprentice. He works as a repairer. Apprentice is a person who works, who learns how to repair, but he is not paid money for it. So unpaid worker, because he is learning something, is called as an apprentice. So he works as a bicycle repairer apprentice in Port Harcourt, and he just comes back after 2 years. After 2 years of working, he comes back to his village and he starts helping, he starts living amidst the villagers. So in spite of having worked all this and coming back, in spite of working, he comes back to his village seeking his fortune, and therefore the villagers, they have high respect for Roof. And moreover, added to all these things, He is not, as I told you, not a mischief monger. The word that is used here is lout. He is not a lout. Lout is a mischief monger. So he is not a lout, and therefore people like him very much. The villagers, will move on quickly to the villagers. Villagers, they are the people who are very innocent and very humble. The author, he says, people do not require any kind of assistance or guidance. It's not that they are not wise. They are very wise people. The group, the people of this village called Umofia, it already belonged as one mass, one big group to the PAP, People's Alliance Party. The villagers have already surrendered themselves, they have given up themselves to PAP and its leader. They had done this. So they have lot of honor and trust and love towards both of them, Marcus and Ruth. Both of them they love, and they now have realized that they had underrated, they had degraded the ballot paper in the previous election. So now they have decided that they'll have to cast their exercise, they'll have to cast their vote in a better manner. So now they have decided that they'll have to vote for profit. They also have understood that once power is given to a man or a person after winning the election, he comes into power, there are many things that are benefited, you know, that the man is benefited with. He gets lot of money. He gets lot of wealth, he gets titles to him, he can buy car, he can build houses. So people have seen this in Marcus Ibe, their leader. So now they have understood that there has to be a radical change in their feeling. They have realized and they have a radical feeling. See, radical change means a fundamental change in the thought. Fundamental change in their thought or thinking is that the previous election they had simply for free voted for Marcus, but that time, in the coming elections, they have decided to take it more seriously and they have decided to vote for at least a slight benefit. So that is their mentality now. Coming to Marcus, Marcus is the leader, is the current minister. He is also called as Chief the Honorable Marcus Ibe. That is a title he has got. So Chief the Honorable Marcus Ibe is the Minister of Culture from PAP, People's Alliance Party. So he has been elected, and people, they can understand that how this power, authority has given him lots and lots of wealth, because they had seen Marcus as a very simple mission school teacher. Just before he had come into politics, he was a mission school teacher. Mission means a kind of aim. Mission schools are schools that were started by the Europeans who came to India, the Britishers who came to, who went into different colonies, into different countries. They started missionary schools over there. Their intention was to spread two things. The first thing was language, second thing was their religion. They had to spread their religion to make the people understand what their religion said. They wanted them to learn English. So through the schools, they spread their religion. So that is what a mission school is. So for this mission school, Marcus Ibe was a teacher. And he was forced to leave the job because his job was at risk. A female teacher had complained against Marcus. Probably they had a fight or something like that, and there was a chance that Marcus would leave his job. He would lose his job. So at that time, at the right time, politics had come into Mofia, and very sensibly, very aptly, and very intelligently, Marcus had jumped into politics. He had jumped into People's Alliance Party, and then he had won the election. After winning the election, this man becomes very popular. He becomes popular, rich, wealthy, and also he gets lots and lots of titles to him. People understand that this is the power of their ballot paper. This is the power of election and voting. So now they have decided that this man has to, he has to be elected, but he has to, they have to make some benefit. Marcus also, he loves his village and villagers very much. He has built Umofia mansion, he has two big cars, and for the election, he is also getting ready. He is also preparing himself to attract the voters towards him. What are those methods that he has inculcated, he has taken to lure the voters that we will be seeing? Roof, the trusted worker of Marcus Ibe, has hinted to Marcus about the radical change in the minds of people. The radical change that they will have to vote for Marcus for a benefit. So Marcus is also prepared to win this election. What conditions, what preparations does he do? See, Marcus would have built a big mansion for himself in the village. There are many beautiful things about Marcus. He, you know, wherever he gets time off from his political work, he would always rush back to his village, spend some quality time with the villagers, spend some more time with the village. When compared to the city and when compared to this village, Umofia was a very backward place. It really actually had no electricity, no running water, nothing. But still, it attracted Marcus. Marcus wanted to do all these things because he had to gain the confidence of his villagers, his fortune. The villagers for him, they were his fortune. He comes back there, every time he spends some time, he gives them a big feast, he talks to them, understands their problem. So the villagers are completely, their heart is completely gone out to Marcus. They all feel that Marcus is a trustworthy son and he is really a unselfish person who is ready to work for the village. Apart from this, preparation for the election is this way. Marcus has built Umofia Mansion, a very big house, and on the day of its christening means the housewarming ceremony that we have in Indian culture, the naming ceremony and the opening of the house, that's called as the christening. The christening of this ceremony, was of this house, was done by the archbishop. And when this archbishop came to christen the house as Umofia Mansion, he had also invited the villagers. And the villagers had come, they had a lovely feast. Five bulls and numerous goats were slaughtered, beheaded, they were killed. And then they were fed to the villagers. The villagers were extraordinarily happy with the feast. And when they get back home, they just talk to themselves. One old man, he says, "Our son is such a beautiful child. He is not like that martyr that turns back." There are a lot of proverbs. When you read the story thoroughly, you'll understand that there are lots and lots of proverbs that are used. So he says, "He's not like that martyr which will turn back only when its food is coming on its way." So he's not like that. That means to say he's not selfish at all. So he is not a selfish guy, but he is our beloved son. He also talks to the other villagers. See, previous elections, we had underrated the power of ballot paper. Remember, students, whenever you are writing the answers, you'll have to write down certain words. That's the reason why I'm writing so many things on the board. Otherwise, the story is such a simple one, it could be easily understood. The reason why these words have been written to you is that you will have to remember these words, because they become the key points to remember your answers. So they feel that the villagers, coming back to the villagers and what they had thought, they had underrated the power of ballot paper in the previous election, and they had just given, they took the elections very lightly. They had voted for Marcus. Now we have to take vote for benefit. We have to take some kind of benefit from Marcus, who is doing many things in his own style. So this is the thing that they were speaking, and that was a radical change in their mind, in their thinking. Marcus also was ready for this. Who told Marcus about all these things? Yes, of course, it is the trusted campaign leader, trusted worker, Roof, who works as a link between the villagers and Marcus. So he works as a link, and he would have told Marcus, intimated him about all these thoughts in the minds of villagers. So what does Marcus do? He also is prepared. He draws 5 months' salary in advance. This takes off the next five months' salary. He takes off in advance and converts the pounds into some nice shillings. All those months' salary, it was converted. A few of them, they were converted into shillings. And these shillings, they were given in eloquent bags, jute bags. Eloquent here means, in this lesson, it means very attractive and easy to handle. So, eloquent bags, they were given to the campaigning boys. And each of the campaigner, he was given a bag filled with shillings. And these boys, they had to go on something called as a whispering campaign. Remember this word very well. Whispering campaign also means a secret campaign, wherein these people, the campaigners, they go to the house of the leaders, of the villagers, and then they have a deal between them. It's almost like, you know, having a deal. So, we are ready to pay you this much. How much do you want for a vote? And villagers take in money secretly at home, and then they give their vote. They promise to give their vote to this person. So, that is called as a whispering campaign. And Marcus, or for Marcus, Roof was a trusted whispering campaign leader. So, he, under his leadership, there were other campaigners who were doing the campaign. So, these boys who are very bold in going out and reaching out to the people of the village and taking their confidence and finishing off the whispering campaign, they are called as the stalwarts. Stalwarts, in your book it is given, stalwarts are bold and courageous workers who reach out to the people. So, all this was kept ready by Marcus. So, it happens one day that Roof is in the house of a spiritual leader of a high traditional rank, Mr. Ezenwa. In his house, in Ezenwa's house, there are around 5 to 6 of the villagers who are all elderly gentlemen, who are all of them have gathered in Ezenwa's house, and the whispering campaign is on. Roof, he starts talking. He says, see, our village, Umofia, and all of us are blessed because we have our son, Marcus Ibe, in the party of PAP. Because Marcus is there, we are all benefited. Both all of us, like even Roof and the villagers, we have been benefited. And he continues to say, why do you, have you ever thought, why are we so, you know, special? Why are we set aloof from the other villages? It's only because we have given Marcus our votes and we have made him as the leader from our village. So he also continues, whether or not Marcus will win, PAP will definitely come into power. But remember, if we do not vote for Marcus, our village will be at loss. We will be the sufferers. We will not be given enough facilities at all. He mentions about one thing. He talks about the pipe-borne water that the PAP had promised. Pipe-borne water means water that comes through the pipe. So, probably they had a well till then. They had to take the water out from the well. They had to just do that with the help of, you know, taking out through the pulley and all. But now, it will be supplied to us by a pipe. In a pipe. So, let us have that privilege. That is what he thinks, and he tries to attract and kind of convince the villagers. The villagers are all seated in a small circle on very low stools. There is a lamp in the middle, and in front of every villager there are 2 shillings. There are 2 shillings each. Remember, students, here there are certain things, you know, certain norms, certain disciplines. 2 shilling is kept in front of the villager. It is not in his hand. Probably they think that holding the money or taking the money in their hand means commitment. So, they had, until the deal is done, until the campaign is completely over, they do not want to touch the money at all. So, the 2 shillings are just lying on the ground and they start talking. Ezanwa says, yes, we all agree. Roof, whatever you say is correct. Whatever you say about Marcus is correct. Marcus is a great man. He's doing things in his own great style. We are happy that our son from our village has become a leader. But he says, we do not want to leave this feast and then go away into a poor man's dinner or supper. Who would like to leave off this supper? Who would like to leave away this kind of Ozo feast? Ozo feast is one thing that he mentions of. Ozo feast is supposed to be a very grand festival, grand feast. So we don't want to leave this. He also mentions, see, Marcus is doing many things. Yesterday, we had not asked money. And today is our day. We don't want to leave it. Tomorrow also, we might not meet Marcus at all. The villager, as Anwar mentions about Iroko tree. We have climbed Iroko tree. We have to collect as much as firewood as possible. And only then we will be getting down. What does this firewood actually mean? Are they really talking about the sticks and the twigs from the tree? What does this Iroko tree and the firewood talk about? What does it refer to? That we'll be seeing in the next clipping. The villagers who talk about firewood does not actually mean the wood, the twigs or the branches of the tree that they have to cut off from this Iroko tree. The firewood only refers to the benefit, the profit that they can get. See, Marcus is compared to this Iroko tree. Iroko tree is supposed to be a very huge tree whose every part is of some use to a man. In Nigeria, it is called as the Iroko tree. Some every part of it is beneficial. So the villagers here, they say, we have climbed the tree. We just don't want to get down, you know, without collecting all the firewood. We want to collect as many firewood as possible. We want to take all the benefits. So now they say, what does it refer to? It refers that these people, during elections, that is the time, even they have understood that during the election time, that is the time when they can make maximum benefit. So he says, see, now it is the time for us to take all the benefits, take all the uses. Yesterday, we had not asked Marcus because we just underrated everything. We had just given our votes for free. Tomorrow also we will not ask Marcus anything at all. But today is our day. We want to make best use. He also adds, Ezanwa also adds, if Marcus was a poor man, we would have definitely not bothered him asking anything at all. But Marcus is a great man now. He doesn't have to bother too much about anything. So let us also collect some firewood. At this word, firewood, Roof is dumbstruck for a while. He understands what the mentality of the villagers are because he himself also had collected firewood long back. Now, he has been collecting firewood from Marcus. So he understands what this firewood actually means. So he gives us three incidents when he had made, he was at profit. First thing is, he had asked for a very grand and rich robe from Marcus. Robe is a long gown kind of thing. You know, it's just an overcoat. It is very grand one. Long overcoat that are owned by the men in African countries. So he just likes that and he had requested Marcus to give it. And Marcus had happily given it off to Roof. That's one thing. Second thing, he had lot of liberty to go home and go to Roof, Marcus' home and even pull out the refrigerator door and take as many beer bottles as possible. So he was just doing that, and when he took out the fifth bottle, Marcus' wife, she had disregard for him doing all these things, unhappy situation. But instead of scolding or instead of supporting Marcus' wife, Marcus had supported Roof, and his wife was scolded off in front of everyone. So he understands that what place he has in Marcus' life. He understands what great privilege he is enjoying. That's the second thing. Third thing, there was a land dispute and Marcus had to settle, you know, Marcus wanted Roof to get it settled. So for that dispute place, Roof was driven by a chauffeur, you know, driven by a driver in his big car. Not only, you know, he just did not give him the car, but he also drove him to the place. So he says that was capping to the situation. To finish off everything very well, this one was one more privilege. So Marcus has lots and lots of trust on Roof. And therefore, Roof understands what the fire would actually means. The villagers are saying that they have to take in lot of firewood. He understands what do the villagers actually mean by the word firewood. So he thinks about himself, he thinks about the other people, he says, no, I have to understand. So he gets up and then he doesn't want to speak anything else, adjusts his ropes, puts his hand into the eloquent jute bag, takes out one more shilling each, you know, and then places one shilling in front of every villager. So that makes it 3 shillings. But the villagers are not happy at all. They are not happy. They are not just satisfied with 3 shillings. They say no. They just shake their head. No. This is not enough for us. So Marcus, he pushes himself one more time. He gives one more shilling. So it totally makes it 4 shillings. So he places it and then finally he is disturbed. He acts as if he is disturbed. That's what is told to you there. He becomes fake. And then transparently fake, he just fakes it up that as if he's angry, and then he says, I am done, I am through. If you want, you can take this, otherwise you can go and vote for your enemy. So the villagers now understand that was the limit of their decorum. Without losing our decorum, we had come to this deal, we had pushed the deal to 4 shillings. Now, even if we want to further shift it off, that would be not a beneficial one. So the villagers, they understand, and all the 6 of them who are there, they start thanking Roof for the secret campaign, for the 4 shillings he has given. And each one of them, they start giving their speech. Speech in the sense, they give their assurance. They promise Roof that their votes, their wives' votes and their whole family's votes will be to Marcus Ibe only. So this is the deal. This is the whispering campaign done by Roof with the villagers. So all these things are done, and then Roof gets back to his home. The next night, till then, the author says, till then everything was fine according to Roof. But there was a surprise visit from somebody else to his house, and that was from the campaign leaders of POP. This POP is the enemy that he had mentioned while he was having a secret campaign with the villagers. He says, go vote your enemy. The enemy is nothing but the Progressive Opposition Party. And this party was, started to avoid the social, economical, emotional annihilation. Annihilation means destruction. So that was started by the tribes near the coastal region, down the coast of Nigeria. They had started it. And they say that this one was started to avoid this kind of annihilation, this kind of destruction. And the leader of POP is Maduka. Remember, do not get confused, okay? These are very simple names. You'll have to remember, Marcus Ibe is from PAP, Maduka is from POP or POP. So the leader is Maduka, and he also has his own campaigning boys. This POP was supposed to be very rich, very, very rich, and they knew that money could easily attract the voters. Nobody knew how much money POP had let loose in Omofia. They don't know how much money was used for campaigning, but it was sure that the stalwarts or the campaign leaders would be very rich. Because campaign leaders, they could get lots and lots of benefit. The way this POP campaigned was with cars and loudspeakers. All the campaigners, they had been given beautiful cars and loudspeakers. And most of the campaigning boys were the local rowdies and thugs. Okay, thugs are again rowdies. These people who do not know how to handle people properly. So they were the local rascals and rowdies. Okay, so these people were the campaign leaders and they also were given lots and lots of money, but in terms of pounds and not in terms of shillings. So pounds were given to them and they also went on secret campaign. One person, one such campaign leader from POP, he comes into Roof's house. So this one, this arrow shows that there is a link between POP and Roof also. So they come to Roof's house and then the campaign leader from POP knows Roof very well. Both of them could have been called as friends, but they did not have any kind of warm exchange of words. It was a very cold and a business-like meeting. They did not want to talk too much. So they just finished and then Roof sits. He also signs his friend to sit down. And then the immediate action is the POP campaign leader, he takes out 5 pound notes and puts it in front of Roof. And then he says, "We want your vote." Roof is stuck. Doesn't know what to do. Because 5 pounds for one vote. You know, he is also a whispering campaign leader. He knows how to lure people. You know, he knows how to attract the people. He had been doing it through shillings. But the time has come for him to take in pounds and then sell his vote. So Roof quietly decides. He just gets up, walks towards the door, closes the door cautiously, comes back and sits. He just thinks about all these things. And this exercise of going towards the door and closing it, it gives him a lot of time to think. It will give him time as to what he has to do, whether he has to take the money or whether he has to throw the money away on the POP campaign leader's face. He just sits there and he decides. Roof sits back and thinks. The author, Chinua Achebe, he describes Roof as a man of quick decisions. He does not waste a lot of time to take decisions, especially in such cases. So he immediately thinks and he looks at the notes that are put in front of him on the ground. So those are red notes of 1 pound each. So there are 5 notes of 1 pound each, and these red notes, they seem to mesmerize Roof. Mesmerize, like something like hypnotizing. He's completely into it. He is completely taken away, attracted towards these notes. He thinks, he looks at them, and on the notes, he can see the cocoa farmers very busily harvesting. That's the picture on the dollar note. On the pound note. And he takes a decision immediately and he says, "Yes, I will vote." But there are few queries. You know, he puts a question. "I work for Marcus. I can't take this." The campaign leader says, "One vote cast in secret against Marcus will not make a difference. It will not be known outside at all." Then he says, "Okay, fine. I'm ready to take. But will it not be heard outside? Will people not come to know about it?" Then the POP campaign leader, he says, "See, we are after votes, not after gossiping. We don't want to bother who talks what. Whether we win, whether we lose, how many votes we have got, that matters a lot." So this exercise of talking also, brief discussion, Roof is completely into it and he says, "Okay, fine, I'm ready to take the money and vote." But the POP campaign leader does not stop at it. He nudges, N-U-D-G-E-S, nudges, just pushes his elbow into the next person who is sitting next to him and then asks him to go get the thing. So the person, he has a red color cover, you know, he has a cloth and he takes out, he tries to remove that cloth, and then there is a clay pot with all the faces and all decorated on the pot, and there are feathers stuck into it. So that is called as the yee-yee. Yee is a local deity that came from the place Mabanta. Mabanta is a place next to Umofia. And this Mabanta was popular for such things, the spiritual blackmailing, like keeping EE and promising on those things and threatening people in the name of deity. So Mabhanta was famous for this. This EE is taken out, and the POP leader, campaign leader, he asks Roof to promise on EE that he would be voting for Maduka only. So then Roof is disgusted. He is scared, completely taken aback. So the author says his heart, it fell, it just missed a beat because he was very scared. And then he decides again. He says, okay, fine. Let me decide. And then again he says, okay, fine. I'm ready to vote for Maduka. And if not, let this EE take note of it. Let it take care of me. And then this thing is done. And people also, they just move away. After having taken a promise on EE, it is kept back, covered and kept back in the car. Before the POP leader leaves the room, Roof, he just talks a word. He says, one vote will not decrease the victory. It will not stop the victory of Marcus. So the POP leader says, it's okay. People, next time they'll understand that Maduka, he gives out pounds and not shillings. Definitely next time they listen and they'll vote for us. And that finishes the bargain, that finishes the deal. Now, let us put it in simpler words. Roof has sold himself for £5. This is done. This is the second phase of the lesson of the story. Next comes the last and the final part, that is on the election day. On the election day, Roof is very busy trying to show Marcus, who is in his car. Marcus is sitting in his car in the owner's seat and looking after that the election process is going on smoothly. But Roof also, he tries to show that he's a very busy man. He keeps telling the women also that they have to vote for the symbol. There were posters put up. They were also beaten and torn off by the weather. But most importantly, only half or probably less than half the population of Umofia were literates. So they did not know how to read and write. For them, the election or the leader was, the identity of the leader was the symbol. So he keeps telling the women, illiterate women who are ready to go and vote, they have been again and again told by Roof that they have to vote for the symbol car, not for the head. Head, it is the symbol of Maduka. So don't vote for head. It is the symbol car that you have to vote. And the people are jauntily dancing because Marcus, great man, great style. He has also hired a high life band, and the band is set in such a place that the people can, wherever they move, they can listen to the song. They start playing number after number, songs after songs, and people are very happy to going and voting. So Marcus also, he sees that every person will definitely vote. So the next target for him would be the campaigners, who are very busy from the morning. They were, actually the last minute campaigning was done. They were just reminding the villagers to go and vote. So Marcus now, he calls Roof and he says, see, the crowd has somewhat decreased. Now you go and vote first, Marcus. Roof, I want you to vote and finish the exercise. Till that time, Roof was happy. Roof was happily doing his work. But the moment he has to, exercise the power, he has to go and vote. Now he is taken back, because he's already sold his ethics. He's already sold himself, sold his vote. But he has to act as if he still works honestly for Marcus. He knows that he is in a completely torn and dilemma condition. So he just says, okay, fine, I'll go. And then he goes there. He is frisked through everywhere. He's checked up. And then the policeman asks him to go in. And he goes there. Till then, he'll be, he would have masked this exertion, the pressure in him. It was masked. But now, the time has come for him to take off this mask and then act smart. He goes into the booth and then he has to vote over there. He is, as I told you, frisked through. The policeman asks him to go into the booth, and then he goes into the place. He just moves. There is a word that is given, fiddle. He just moves sideways like this. He pushes himself into the booth, and then he sees that there are two boxes. The two boxes, one has the symbol head and the other has the symbol car. He has his ballot paper in his hand and he has to vote to the person whom he likes, whether it is the head or the car. What does our leader, so far he's been a leader, so far he's been a hero of this story, what does he do? He doesn't know whether he has to vote for Marcus, his beloved Marcus, who has been giving him lot of firewood, or he has to vote for Maduka, who has given him 5 pounds. So he is confused. He stands there for a while, again giving time for himself to think. And he stands there with his ballot paper in his hand. Roof, he is confronted by 2 ballot boxes. He stands there and he looks at the symbols, the head and the car. Again, in a dilemma, in a confused state, he thinks. At that point of time, he realizes what a big blunder he has done. How could he, even in his wildest dreams, think of cheating Marcus, who was a very beloved person for him? He doesn't want to cheat Marcus, even in secret, even without his knowledge, he doesn't want to cheat him. Second thought that comes to his mind is, okay, let me go and give those 5 pounds to that man. I don't want to vote. But what about the E? E is more fearsome. E is more scary than the 5 pounds. And he says, no, I have come to that point of time where I can't go back. But I have to act. So suddenly he thinks, and there is a voice that, you know, awakens him, brings him out of this thought. That is the voice of the policeman who is standing outside. Outside the door, there's a policeman, and he says, what is that man doing still inside? Hasn't he still finished voting? Because voting process, you know, students, it takes just a 30-second or probably 1-minute process for one person. It should be a very quick exercise. This man is standing and he's trying to think something. So the policeman just awakens him and he says, what is that person doing? So suddenly he comes out, and then there comes an idea into his mind. There is a thought that comes like a lightning. And then he folds the ballot paper. He folds the paper that he has into 2 pieces, into 2 halves. And the crease that is made, he tears it up. He tears at the crease, and then he puts each piece into 1 box. So he is now happy that he has voted for both Marcus and for Maduka. He only gives the first part of it, which has the Maduka's name. He puts it into Maduka's paper only, in box only. And then he affirms. He says that he has finished his exercise and I vote for Maduka, he says. And then he comes out. He comes out, the author says, with the same springy motion that with which he had gone inside. He has a jaunty movement. Jauntily he comes back. Jauntily means very happily and carelessly. He is just moving with lot of happiness in his posture, in his way of walking. So he is relieved of the tension that he had carried from many days. So now he is, the whole thing is done. Again, the spring and the jauntiness has come back into his action, into his walking, and he is out of the voting booth. He has just gone out. So this completes the whole story of the voter. I know there are doubts in your mind. The next question you would be asking is, who won the election? The second question would be, ma'am, could this kind of voting be done? Now, tearing the ballot paper into 2 and throwing it into 1 box each. Actually, dear students, this would become an invalid vote. So it neither counts. It is neither for Maduka nor for Marcus. So he has not voted for anybody at all, because he has worked for both. You know, he is for both of them. He has worked for Marcus, but he is bond. He has sold himself for Maduka. So he is confused. He wants to show that his vote also becomes invalid, like the person he is. He is also not a true and honest person. works for somebody, votes for somebody. So the ballot paper also, the paper that he has put, that also has become, you know, it is invalid. It is neither this one nor that one. So the whole of this lesson, it talks, I know in the initial stages, we talk about the effect of colonization, the effect of British rule on the Igbo culture, Igbo society, and the Igbo tribals. But later on, when the, you know, after a half of it, when especially when Roof starts, you know, he's taken the money, we think, we start talking about the ethical values, the moral values of human beings. So is it just that? Can a man's morality be measured by money? So if money, if anybody is ready to give us money, are we ready to sell ourselves? Is there no meaning for fidelity at all? Is there no meaning for loyalty at all? So all these questions come to us. So who won the election doesn't matter, because, you know, we had known that Marcus would win something called a landslide victory. That was already known, and Marcus would definitely win. But what we are concerned here is the dilemma, the splitting into two action of Roof's mentality. He is completely divided between two things. One is Marcus and the other is Maduka. His honesty and his poverty. Both of them have played a very important role in his life. So this is what happens to the voter. The voters can be attracted by many things, and Roof is one such example. So the whole of the story could be summarized this way. I hope the story is understood. The next part again for us is to start learning the questions and answers and how to write the answers for this. So we shall do that in the next bit. Okay.